on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion 23370 in the name of Graham Day on Scottish Government support for the Veterans and Armed Forces Community in Scotland 2020. Can I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now? I call on Graham Day to speak to and move the motion. Minister, please.
Presiding Officer, I'm delighted to present the Scottish Government's fourth annual update to Parliament on support for veterans and the armed forces community. Let me begin by moving the motion in my name and advise the Parliament that the Government will support the Labour amendment as well. Presiding Officer, since 2017, we've committed to return to the Chamber annually to update members and showcase the work we're doing to improve services, support and ensure no disadvantage for serving personnel, veterans and their families. I welcome the opportunity to deliver this update. This week we published Scottish Government support for Veterans and Armed Forces Community 2020, detailing fully what we're doing across ministerial portfolios and how we are working with partners in the public, private and third sectors. Cross-cutting collaborative teamwork is at the heart of this Government's approach, and it's perhaps no better highlighted than through the Veterans Strategy. In January, we published our strategy response detailing how we will deliver our commitments through to 2028. Taking the strategy forward in Scotland will be a collaborative effort, as I say, across government and with the veterans community, and I'm committed to continuing our joint working approach to improve the lives of serving personnel, veterans and their families. By supporting effective collaboration, we see a force multiplier and improved outcomes. The best example of this I've seen is the Unforgotten Forces Consortium, a partnership of charitable organisations delivering services to older veterans in Scotland. And I was pleased, in fact delighted, to announce earlier this year that the Scottish Government is to contribute £750,000 to the consortium over 3 years to improve the health, wellbeing and quality of life for veterans in Scotland. And I think that was a gesture of support for the work that the consortium has been doing, but also the model. The Scottish Veterans Fund is another example of public, private and charitable sector collaboration. We continue to invest in the fund, and this year, in partnership with Standard Life Aberdeen, funded 15 projects totalling over £165,000. Since 2008, more than 170 projects have received over £1.6 million from the fund. And I should tell Parliament the criteria for bids this year was extended to include projects addressing the impact of COVID-19 on the veterans community. Presiding Officer, I've been clear that supporting veterans and their families develop their skills and find fulfilling, meaningful employment is a priority. I was delighted to announce a recent refresh of the Veterans Employability Strategic Group, with new co-chairs developing an ambitious vision. Originally formed following a Veterans Commissioner recommendation, it still has an important role to play in improving the opportunities for veterans in Scotland. And I believe it will benefit greatly from the fresh pair of eyes our external co-chair, Sue Bonfrey, will bring. Many in this chamber will have met Sue in her role at Barclays, where she very much walked the walk on veterans. I believe she's the perfect choice for this post. And on the subject of walking the walk, I can also announce progress regarding veterans' employment within government. The Scottish Government is offering work placements to service leavers and veterans through the Going Forward into Employment programme. Working with Career Transition Partnership, we will onboard ex-service personnel through short placements and fixed-term appointments, which could subsequently be converted to permanent roles. I'm delighted that the first two candidates are expected to join the Scottish Government in a matter of months. Furthermore, following engagement with the Officers Association Scotland, 9 veterans are now in temporary roles within the Scottish Government, primarily to support our response to COVID-19, with more to be joining soon. The nature of these appointments will not permit conversion to permanent roles, but it is another positive step in providing employment opportunities and experience for veterans. In relation to skills, the Scottish Government has committed to fund to 2023 the valuable work on mapping military qualifications against those recognised by employers. This will help employers and educational institutions understand the skills and expertise service leavers have to offer, and support individuals to articulate their skills. Initially, this work has been focused on infantry qualifications, but it is now beginning to look at Navy catering services. I'd also highlight the project being led by Skills Development Scotland to support veterans develop their skills and help address a significant gap in the nation's cyber security workforce. Funded by the Scottish Government, it aims to reskill those with military security training and experience for roles including security consultants and operations centre managers. It was developed following research commissioned by SDS, looking into ways career changers and the unemployed could be reskilled for cybersecurity careers using alternative, flexible and accessible pathways. The project will add technical cyber skills to the students' existing training and experience, and 20 ex-military participants are taking part in the 8-week programme to learn ethical hacking and penetration skills at Aberdeen University and through online study and work placements. The programme restarted in September, having been interrupted by COVID-19. But it's not only the serving personnel and veterans who need our support. I remain determined that we can do all we can to help families too. Service children needing additional support for learning because of their parents' service will have their needs met through the Additional Support for Learning framework. The Scottish Government published its response to the review of the implementation of Additional Support for Learning in October and accepted all the recommendations. We will continue to work with partners to deliver those actions, ensuring that children and young people can flourish in their learning and beyond. Presiding Officer, I can also announce today that at the beginning of November, a refresh of the Capitalising on Military Talent Toolkit will be formally launched to include information on the benefits of employing military family members, particularly spouses and partners, and improve the knowledge of employers on how to do this successfully, enabling more partners and family members to secure good quality employment and continue to participate in progress in the workplace. My ministerial colleagues and I are also committed to improving access and removing barriers to healthcare for the veterans and armed forces community. And I'm delighted that the Scottish Veterans Care Network will, having suffered a rollout delay caused by the pandemic, be formally launched later this week with an immediate focus to develop a mental health action plan. Improving veterans' mental health is a priority, and this year we invested £1.4 million in combat stress and provided joint funding with 6 health boards for the Veterans First Point Network. Since 2017, the Scottish Government has provided nearly £3 million to support Veterans First Point services, and I'm pleased to confirm that funding for V1P will continue at the current level for the year 2021-22. We continue to work closely with local authorities, and I'm committed to supporting our Champions Network. This year, we distributed Veterans and Armed Forces awareness e-learning to councils, intended particularly for frontline staff, to improve understanding of the Armed Forces Covenant and how the principles should be applied locally. Feedback has been extremely positive, and I look forward to discussing this when I host the Champions at a virtual roundtable next month. On housing, the Scottish Government continues to offer funding from the £1.3 million grant award to Veterans Housing Scotland to support it as it progresses proposals to deliver homes for disabled ex-service personnel. Additionally, the Open Market Shared Equity Scheme, offering successful applicants up to a 40% equity stake in a property, continues to be available to veterans who've left the forces within the past 2 years. Presiding Officer, my ministerial colleagues and I are intent on providing the best support for veterans, service personnel and their families. We will continue to work collaboratively with partners across all sectors to improve that support now and in the future. And I very much look forward to hearing contributions from across the chamber this afternoon. Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. And I call Alec Rowley to speak to move amendment 23370.1. Mr. Rowley, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And moving the amendment to the motion, I would want to say for all those who have served in the military, a military that has been at war for much of my lifetime, reintegrating into civilian life can be challenging. So are we doing enough to ease this transition for those who have served and sacrificed so much on our behalf? I do believe that there is a much better recognition of the challenges military personnel face, and I do want to say that since the inception of this Parliament, the inception of devolution, there has been good progress made. So, has devolution worked for veterans? My view is it has. But that said, there is much more to be done. The transition from uniform duty to civilian status is not just a change of jobs. It's a change in virtually every aspect of life. Their careers, responsibilities, jobs, homes, communities, lifestyle, healthcare, training, and much, much more. If service members have families, the transition will also mean big changes for spouses and children. Presiding Officer, there are many veterans organisations that have been set up by veterans for veterans and their families that have reported both the demands for support have increased during the COVID period and the ability to raise funds has decreased. That's why we added the amendment.
Richard Lyle.
As a previous councillor, would the member agree that sometimes councils are not doing enough for veterans as they leave and don't give them high enough on the housing waiting list?
Alec Rowley.
I think there's a mix. I mean, the Minister would say more than me, but we have discussed this. There is a mix across local authorities, but I do think progress is being made in near enough every local authority that I've talked to recently. But as I say, that's why we added the amendment today to recognise the issue of COVID and to agree to work with such groups to help them get through. Specifically, we recognise the urgent need for both a Scottish Veterans Care Network and a Veterans Mental Health Plan and welcome steps made towards their development. Mental illness is a common and can affect anyone, including serving and ex-members of armed forces and their families. Some people cope with support from family and friends or by getting help with other issues in their lives. Others need clinical care and treatment, which could be from the NHS, support groups and indeed charities. Although it's completely normal to experience anxiety or depression after traumatic events, this can be tough to deal with. And at a time when demand is already stretched in mental health services and the demand is growing, it is important that governments work with all organisations that provide specific support for veterans. So I would say to the Minister that whilst good progress is being made, many of the Scottish Veterans Commissioner's recommendations have not yet been fully implemented. All of these recommendations surrounding areas like housing, health and employment are essential to ensure veterans are supported in Scotland. In areas like housing, as mentioned, where we have a chronic shortage, I know this is a challenge, but particularly older veterans must be able to rely on safe, good quality and affordable housing. Many people who have fought for their country bring long-term conditions back home with them. We need to make sure that we provide top-class economic and social support for vulnerable veterans who are suffering from PTSD and other debilitating conditions. But as a Fifer, I could not speak in this debate today without mentioning the press headlines this morning that the UK government are proposing to dismantle the Black Watch. In the words of Rob Scott, chairman of the Fife branch of the Black Watch Association, if the decision was taken to remove the Black Watch Battalion from within the Royal Regiment of Scotland, it would be a tragedy not just for history, but also accelerate a downward spiral for the military side of the army in Scotland. So the benefits to the benches opposite, I would say, have a word with your leaders in London, as they seem to be determined to destroy all things Scottish and tell them about the relationship between the Black Watch and communities across Fife and Scotland. And it is that relationship that means there is widespread support for veterans across Scottish communities. I also want to mention the families of those who did not come back from recent conflicts. And I will conclude on that point. Presiding Officer, I have met with many families of those who lost their lives, and I say our Parliament thinks of all those people today and in particularly at this time of year. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rowley. I now call Maurice Corry. Mr. Corry, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yes, I declare an interest as a veteran. I'm very proud to be, and I also am convener of the cross-party group from Armed Forces of Veterans. And yes, I did hear that leak and rumour about the Black Watch, which I take very concerningly. I haven't even looked into it yet, but I was second in command of three Black Watch in Perth, covers Strathmore, Angus and Montrose and Perth and Fife, so I know very well what Mr Rowley is talking about when we manage to recruit successfully in those areas and have drill halls in Dundee, Montrose and Forfar, as well as Perth, obviously, and other areas, so and Kirkcaldy too, as well. Where are we? Well, I'm very pleased indeed to take part in this debate today in support of our veterans across Scotland and the efforts made to champion what they have to offer. Now, we shall be supporting the government's motion today and indeed Labour's motion, because I quite understand where my colleague Mr Rowley is coming from in relation to supporting the charities which need so much support at this moment, in kind and particularly in advice and general support. The dedication of servicemen and women in protecting our country is of the highest standard and most recently evidenced in their immediate assistance with the UK's COVID-19 response. Their contribution means they deserve every opportunity to succeed when they return to civilian life, and this requires continued partners' support from across our sectors and at every level of government to make it possible. The strategy for our veterans, as published in 2018, was the collective work of the UK government and devolved administrations across the UK. And these collaborative efforts were driven not by party or political gain, but for a recognised need to promote a multi-level coordination of veteran support to ensure that service leavers not only transition well, but truly excel in whatever they choose to do. Now, with this joined-up approach, our governments and veteran stakeholders work to highlight and maximise the wide-ranging skills and abilities of our veterans. And now, more than ever, this coordinated approach must continue to improve signposting and increase awareness of the help available. Now, I welcome the work of the Scottish Government and the Minister in building on this strategy, and based on its own far-reaching consultation, it abides by commendable principles that veterans are of value and of benefit to society, and they should be encouraged and equipped to maximise their potential. And that every veteran should be able to access support and advice at the point of need. Now, I believe every effort is being made by both the Scottish and UK governments in working to achieve these principles. And thankfully, veteran support has generally come a long way, especially in the last decade. And we have seen a welcome shift in the narrative, one which moves on from the tired notion of one-size-fits-all approach to the veteran support. And of course, many ex-service personnel transition back into society very successfully and pursue their chosen career without requiring additional support. But some individuals experience challenges, such as securing a house, as referred to earlier, or steady work, or managing their physical and mental well-being. But unfortunately, COVID-19 has exacerbated these issues. Employment is one such example where already job criteria can often be overly specific despite a veteran's clear ability and capability for a role. And indeed, I hope the Scottish Government will focus on intensifying more businesses to put their support of the Armed Forces Covenant into practice, particularly regarding the recruitment of early and younger early service leavers, where I believe there is space for improvement. And I'm delighted to hear the Minister's statement today about more emphasis on employment opportunities and skills related to that and training and qualifications. Given these challenging circumstances, the response of veterans organisations and charities in Scotland has been nothing short of inspiring and operating under very heavy constraints. Most have fought to adapt and increase their services to answer heightened demand, particularly in cases of social isolation and anxiety. For example, SAFA has established an emergency response fund which has assisted veterans with accessing benefits and entitlements. And for example, in Helensburgh over the weekend, I was involved in a SAFA case, which became a SAFA case, of a Welsh infantryman who unfortunately had been sleeping on the streets for too long, and we managed to bring him inside into temporary accommodation thanks to SAFA and the council, Argyll and Bute Council, working well. A superb example of where it is working when we put our mind to it. And that veteran is now being taken under care in relation to managing his housing needs as we go forward. Combat Stress, with financial support from Armed Forces Covenant Fund Trust, has launched a digital treatment and support platform which will offer rehabilitative programmes and resources to improve mental health. Now, Veterans Gateway, as a first point of contact for all veterans in the UK, continues its 24/7 assistance with finances, employment, housing and physical and mental well-being. And at this point, I would like to again emphasise to the Minister my concern and my wish, and we know we're going to discuss it, about including now Merchant Navy veterans in Scotland. I think that's so important, and we know we've discussed this before over the presence of a lot of them on the islands and our rural areas. Organisations such as these, numbering 300 in Scotland, provide a wealth of practical, tailor-made support for veterans who require it, and crucially, their families as well, collaborative referral pathways are evident with Veterans Gateway, and Unforgotten Forces for the Older Veterans Consortium have proved integral to remove barriers or complexities. Now, I do welcome additional funding from the Scottish Government for them. Of course, virtually operated services cannot replace normal face-to-face advice. And also, the government will want to continue and encourage its work in this area and overcome these hurdles. Now, obviously, there is a sector of
I'm sorry, Mr. Corey, I haven't given you an extra minute. If you could just begin to wind up, I'm smiling at you benignly.
I'm trying to conclude, okay? Yet, as I say, so to conclude, the responsibility to support the veterans community lies not with one organisation nor with one government. The UK and devolved governments, along with our private and charity stakeholders, indeed the wider public, all share accountability to promote the skills and experience of our veterans. And with greater signposting coordination of help, this is the most fitting way we can show our gratitude to their service. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Mr. Rumbles, in fairness to you, if you take an extra minute, I won't grumble.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. If I may, I can mention to Maurice Curry my own Black Watch credentials. I served with the Black Watch and the other Scottish Infantry Regiments during my very first posting, Army posting to Glencorse Barracks back in 1980 and 1881. So it was some time ago, but there we are. I very much welcome this annual debate focusing as it does on the welfare of our Armed Forces veterans. I have to say, though, that I can't help finding it a little difficult to refer myself as a veteran. But, you know, I left the Army when I was just 38. But that, since I'm approaching retirement age, perhaps I'll get more used to it. During this parliamentary term, I've repeatedly taken this annual opportunity to highlight the difficulties, particularly in access to health services, that face veterans who live in the Grampian Health Board area. I've long argued that our veterans, wherever they may live in Scotland, should have the same access to NHS physical and mental health services. In last year's debate, I was for the first time heartened by the approach of the Scottish Government in seriously addressing this issue. I was particularly taken with the personal commitment of Graham Day, the Minister for Veterans, to tackle this. It does build on the work of his predecessor too. I was pleased to hear that the Minister was to launch a National Veterans Care Network in the spring of this year. This network was to provide service improvement and planning across the whole country, ensuring that veterans have access to specialist care from anywhere they live in Scotland. Now, this is exactly what I've been calling for since I came back into Parliament in 2016. However, the launch of the network has been understandably delayed by the focus on tackling the COVID-19 pandemic. And as I say, I totally accept the reasons for this delay. It was great news that the network is to be launched this week on the 19th. And I wholeheartedly commend the Minister for his efforts to ensure that this takes place. I wondered if, in his summing up, I wonder if he could commit to perhaps brief members of the Parliament who are particularly interested in this on how the network will actually operate. That would be very helpful. Because, of course, there is much in this field still to be done. In June, the Scottish Veterans Commissioner published an update on how things were going. He covered transition, housing, employability, skills and learning, and health and well-being. It was a snapshot on how well government was doing against previous recommendations. Of the 63 recommendations, 18 had been fully implemented, with 2 being superseded. In the time available, I'll not go into these in depth, but it does indicate that Graham Day should be commended for driving these forward. There is, as I say, though, much still to be done. Presiding Officer, I'll be retiring from the Scottish Parliament in May. I now see with a new bill that's been published this morning that it's the 5th of May rather than the end of March, but there we are. But I'm pleased to say that in my time here, I have seen a much-needed improvement in the services that are to be made available across all parts of Scotland, and I mean all parts of Scotland, particularly my area in the North East for all our veterans. And I'm glad I've had the opportunity to say so and put that on the record. Now, I know the presiding officer said I had extra time. It's funny that, because I really prepared a very short contribution, and the very moment I do that, she gives me more time. But there we go, that's the way of life. I'll end my contribution to this debate by saying, well done to the minister. Now, you don't often hear that from me, do you? Well done to the minister for his personal commitment and getting the National Veterans Care Network launched this week. Long may the good work continue, because there is certainly much more to do. Thank you.
Thank you. Just because I give you an extra minute doesn't mean you have to use it. We now move to the open debate, and I call Annabel Ewing, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And at the outset, I would wish to mark my appreciation of and thanks to our Veterans and Armed Forces community. It is indeed a very special community, a huge asset to Scotland, and one which makes an enormous contribution to our country. And I would also wish to commend both the SNP Scottish Government and the Minister in particular for their continuing unwavering support to the community and their determination to put veterans on the map. Indeed, this government was the first in the life of our reconvened Scottish Parliament to have a Veterans Minister, and it was the first to appoint an independent Scottish Veterans Commissioner, the first indeed across these aisles. Another key structural innovation, of course, is the establishment across local councils and NHS health boards of veterans champions. And I would take this opportunity to commend the significant contribution within Fife Council of the veterans champion there, Councillor Rod Kavanagh, who himself is a former Marine. In the short time available, I would wish to focus on three specific issues. First of all, as has been mentioned, the important issue of mental health. Not all veterans make the transition easily to civilian life, and so we need to support them in that transition. And I very much welcome the further funding announced today to First Point Scotland, who provide a pivotal role in that regard. And I'm very pleased indeed to note that as part of their regional network, their base in Fife is in Carden Den, in my constituency of Cowdenbeath. The next issue I would wish to mention, of course, is housing, and that also has been mentioned. And whilst there's a lot of activity that is going on, and I commend the Scottish Government for that, including the ongoing work to develop a veteran homelessness prevention pathway, nonetheless, I think there's still more that can be done. And I'm thinking here in particular of adaptations. And even where SAFA is involved, and they provide invaluable support in my experience, but even in those circumstances, it can be quite difficult to get things moving in a timely manner. And I hope the Minister can use his good offices in that regard. The third issue, of course, concerns employability and transferable skills. And again, I note the good work that is going on here. The Minister referred to some of it in his opening statement. And I'm very particularly interested in the work of the Scottish Credit and Qualifications Framework Partnership, which is working on the mapping of military qualifications in terms of those recognised, in fact, by employers in Scotland. But again, there's more to be done. And I would imagine that employers could be doing a lot more in this regard. And I would urge them to step up to the plate. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I am indeed proud of the Scottish Government's continued commitment to our veterans and armed forces community. And this must sadly be contrasted with the devastating news in today's paper that yet another UK government, this time of a Tory hue, has got the Black Watch in their sights. And indeed, for the sake of completeness, who can forget the then Labour Defence Secretary, Geoff Hoon, who started the amalgamation process in 2004 and made the announcement on the very day that the Black Watch were returning from their second back-to-back tour of duty in Iraq. Presiding Officer, another day, another Westminster betrayal. Thank you.
Microphone. Peter Chapman, followed by Keith Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I welcome the opportunity to speak about the annual Veterans Update and how both the UK and the Scottish Governments can continue to protect and support our veterans who have sacrificed and indeed continue to sacrifice so much for our country. The role of the armed services during the nation's most recent time of need, COVID-19, cannot be overstated. from setting up hospitals to ensuring mobile testing units were available to support care homes and rural areas with local testing, including in Peterhead in my local area, was a real bonus. And it is reassuring to know that once more, in our time of need, the armed forces are again ready and able to step up and support us. It was with this in mind that I am glad to hear that the UK and Scottish governments continue to work together to achieve the goals set out in the strategy for our veterans and continue to achieve these aims in addressing the immediate needs of older veterans and indeed to develop ways for the newer generation of veterans to be empowered and supported. It is encouraging to note that the Scottish Government's consultation on veteran support in Scotland found no significant gaps in support for veterans, but outlined areas where improvements could be made. Indeed, constant improvement in veteran support should always be strived for and achieved. And I am pleased that the UK Government has committed £6 million of extra funding to armed forces charities to support veterans, personnel and their families through the pandemic, and has also set up a new Office for Veterans Affairs. This new office has been tasked with delivering better outcomes for veterans, particularly focusing on mental health, employment and housing. Indeed, the launch of the website HeadFit, a site that allows 24/7 access to online self-help tools that aim to enhance mood, drive and confidence, as well as manage the stresses of everyday life, shows the importance and emphasis on ensuring veterans have access to tools that aid mental as well as physical trauma. The Scottish Government has also provided significant funding to the Unforgotten Forces Partnership to ensure they can continue their vital work. The Scottish Veteran Fund also continues to allocate funding to projects ranging from the provision of mental health support, employment opportunities to housing support for veterans. And an area that I would like to personally highlight in achieving the goals of the strategy for our veterans is the use of the third sector. In 2019, there were 291 armed forces charities operating in Scotland. And I would particularly like to highlight the efforts of Joyce McMillan, who is the Scottish coordinator of Soldiers Off the Street and also runs a charity shop in Fraserburgh that aims to support veterans and their families. And Joyce is a real enthusiast, and with her team around her, she makes a real difference to our veterans in the North East. And I say thank you, Joyce, for your dedication. And it would also be remiss of me to not highlight the extraordinary efforts of armed forces charities in adapting to the challenges of COVID-19 this year and providing opportunities to people to mark Remembrance Day virtually and through other means. And I would say, Presiding Officer, it was a very strange and quiet occasion this year in Fraserburgh, where we normally have hundreds of people marching to the monument for the laying of wreaths. It was a very quiet affair this year. And, Presiding Officer, all of us here recognise the need for help available to veterans in their hour of need, just as they continue to be there for our hour of need. And this, I'm sure we all agree, is an issue that transcends party politics, and I call upon both the UK and the Scottish Governments to work together with the third sector to ensure the needs of our veterans are met. Presiding Officer.
Keith Brown, followed by Mary Fee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate today on the fourth annual update on support for the armed forces and veterans community in Scotland. And it may well be our last debate in this session, I'm not sure, but if it is, can I just take the opportunity, and I can't believe I'm going to use these words, to join with Mike Rumbles in congratulating the Minister for the work that he's done over the past two and more years, working with veterans organisations and other parties. He's shown a real and genuine personal commitment. I can also mention the work of Maurice Corrie over these years in terms of the cross-party group. There's no question about the commitment that Maurice has shown to all sorts of veterans organisations right across the whole of Scotland, so well done to him as well. Can I also say that I am very proud that the Scottish Government's commitment to the Armed Forces and Veterans Community is a matter of public record, not least the appointment of a Scottish Veterans Commissioner, which was the first of its kind anywhere in the UK. In August, President Officer, I submitted a motion to the Parliament celebrating the 10th anniversary of the Armed Services Advice Project, which has been crucial in ensuring that veterans and their families get the support they are entitled to and deserve. And I thank all the members across this chamber who supported that motion, as well as those who supported my more recent motion on the Falkland Islands, which celebrates the removal of all landmines from the Falkland Islands. The Armed Services Advice Project is run by Citizens Advice Scotland and is funded by a coalition of military charities since it was founded in 2010. And since that time, it's supported over 16,000 people, unlocking nearly £18 million. That's an extraordinary amount of money. And when you look at some of the individual cases involved, the change it's made to people's lives, veterans' lives, is absolutely huge in many cases. And this, of course, is money that they're perfectly entitled to. But either through reluctance or because they're not aware of them, they haven't picked up these benefits. It includes welfare benefits, unpaid wages, compensation and other funding sources. So, President Officer, I'd like to take the opportunity to record my thanks to this project for the advice and support they've been able to provide to my constituents over the last 10 years, not least through a particular individual, Ali Gemmell, who works in Stirling but has worked with veterans in my local area. And in particular, highlight the hard work and commitment of Ali and his staff. Ali is the Regional Support Officer. As I say, they cover my constituency both in Clackmannanshire and in parts of Stirling, and they provide an absolutely excellent service, including sometimes a life-changing service to those veterans who receive their support. As is recognised in so many areas, we have to drive responses by including, of course, the lived experience of individuals. And that's exactly the approach that the Armed Services Advice Project takes. And it was the perfect organisation to work with the Money Advice Trust to ensure their guide how to deal with debt, which is funded by the Scottish Government and is due for launch later this year, addresses the specific needs of the veterans community. Presiding Officer, despite the challenges we have faced over the last year, I'm very pleased to see sustained progress being made to support the veterans and armed forces community, and to note that adjustments have been made as a result of the pandemic, which has obviously provided a challenge for people in that community. I certainly agree with the point made by Alec Riley that devolution has been extremely good for veterans and the armed forces community in Scotland. I can also say as well, in relation to the Black Watch, the reason why this is important and why it should feature in this debate is because the support structure, pastoral support and otherwise, for locally driven recruitment areas which serve particular regiments is absolutely vital to veterans. And I would certainly hope that as a result of this debate that we'll have a united approach from within the chamber. It may be there's nothing to this story. Maybe the UK government doesn't intend to do this, but if it does, a united approach in this chamber to speak out against any attempt to remove the Black Watch would be very welcome. And I suppose on that point, I should also declare an interest. My grandfather served with the Black Watch in 1918. In fact, as a toddler, he used to regularly regale me with stories about a young guy called Mike Rumbles at the time and some of the things that they got up to when they were both in the Black Watch. I can't believe I started and finished the speech with reference to Mike Rumbles. But it is a very important point. The communities which our service personnel join, the regiments that they join, are extremely important to them after they've left that service. And I would certainly hope you'll see no further reduction in the regiments in Scotland. But well done to the Minister, and of course, well done to Maurice Corrie as well. Thank you.
Mary Fee, please, followed by Maureen Watt.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and my thanks to Graeme Day for bringing this debate to the Chamber. Last week, I had the privilege to take part in the Remembrance Day debate and spoke of some charities that assist our veterans, ensuring support is there for both serving and ex-service personnel. And the Scottish Government has responsibility to veterans on several devolved issues, including housing, health, social care, skills, employability and education. And there are around 400,000 veterans in Scotland and over 500,000 when the complete ex-service community, including families, is taken into account. And the Scottish Government are committed to ensuring that no member of the armed forces, service family member or veteran faces disadvantage. And with today's debate, I'd like to focus on mental health and the need for continual support throughout, especially for our servicemen and women. And I'd also like to highlight charities such as Combat Stress and Rock to Recovery. Both have been working hard to develop online resources providing peer support as well as maintaining helpline contacts aimed at coaching veterans and keeping them informed of techniques that may assist them in their time of need. And some veterans with mental health issues may find themselves turning to drugs to facilitate their trauma. And this can vary from alcohol, prescribed medication, or illegal drug use. And in last week's debate, I mentioned the Glasgow-based charity Coming Home. And I spoke of the challenges that they faced at the beginning of lockdown, the importance of repetitiveness and familiarity, problems being heard, and of course, essential food packages being delivered. And with regards to mental health and well-being, they told me that a more joined-up method for support agencies is vital, as each individual service person has different circumstances, and a one-size-fits-all approach will always leave someone behind. And, Presiding Officer, if I can give an example of a veteran that they are working with, who has tried on numerous occasions to take his own life with prescribed medication. Now his GP will not prescribe until he is receiving help from an addiction team. The addiction team have a waiting list, and as he is now homeless, it's been difficult to negotiate with neighbouring councils to take responsibility for this veteran in his time of need. And Combat Stress report that it's important to note that as well as alcohol and drug consumption, chronic pain should be considered. In these cases, chronic pain itself may actually serve as a reminder of a traumatic event, which will often make a veteran's psychological symptoms even worse, leading to feeling low in mood or that life is not worth living. Many veterans struggle with feelings of frustration and anger, and this may feel more intense due to the recent pandemic. They also state that military training means being very alert to hidden dangers, along with the ability to become angry and aggressive very quickly. And this can be useful in the military and often necessary when on active duty, but not in civilian life. Some veterans may also be left feeling angry about their experiences. And building up relationships and trust is necessary, as opening up about their lived experience can increase cases of post-traumatic stress. And the first step of agreeing to support is not an easy task. And once that trust has been gained, a referral can be made. But many support agencies, such as rehabilitation centres, require being alcohol or drug-free for 4 weeks. Addiction teams are vital, but when waiting lists are long, it becomes a continuous merry-go-round. That's why it's vital that there is more support for serving and ex-service personnel experiencing mental health problems. That's why increased funding for our veterans is necessary and should be considered as a matter of urgency. And in closing, Presiding Officer, it has been a privilege to take part in this very important and timely debate. Thank you.
Maureen Watt, followed by Michelle Ballantyne.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Following last week's debate on remembrance commemorations, as Mary Fee has said, it's fitting that this week we're discussing support for veterans and for the armed forces community. The UK government, well, armed forces and defence in general is still a responsibility of the UK government. It's right that the duty of care is shared with devolved governments and partners across all sectors. And the establishment of the Scottish Veterans Commissioner has been a really important step in ensuring that progress in supporting veterans and their families is one of continuous progress and improvement. Those leaving the armed forces and choosing Scotland as their home for themselves and their families are greatly valued for the contribution they make to life in Scotland. In the northeast of Scotland, many former army personnel or armed services personnel have over the years found employment in the oil and gas sector, not least because of the many transferable skills they lived during their time in the forces. And also perhaps that the harsh environment that they have experienced in the forces makes offshore not that much different, if indeed they are employed in the offshore environment. Nonetheless, transition to civilian life can sometimes be problematic. so I therefore welcome the offer of work placements and fixed-term appointments to veterans through the Going Forward into Employment programme. Presiding Officer, one of the enduring concerns of those involved with armed forces and their families has been that of the education of forces children. Getting it right for every child has special resonance for children who may have had many more moves during their education than others. And I commend the work that COSLA and the General Teaching Council of Scotland especially are doing in this field. And I should also mention the work that the GTCS are doing to overcome barriers for teachers who may not quite have the right qualifications for working in Scotland, but are working with those to make sure that their qualifications can be recognised or indeed that they can get further qualifications. The condition of housing stock of forces families on the bases has increasingly become an issue as we always have one eye on climate change and look to make sure that everyone has a warm, well-insulated house. And it would be good to think that we're moving towards more cooperation between the armed forces and local authorities on this. And it's heartening that in new housing construction, discussion with veterans charities has meant that bespoke homes for veterans with disabilities are now increasingly being built, but perhaps not at the pace that we would like. Presiding Officer, for the vast majority of veterans, transition to civilian life is relatively smooth, and we shouldn't forget that. However, this transition can be very difficult for some, compounded by traumatic events that they may have experienced in action, and who go on to experience PTSD, which affects not only the person themselves, but the whole family. And like many other MSPs, I've had to help families in such situations. As Maurice Corry has said, there are many veterans charities and much more coordinated help than previously. There are now many veterans charities, many well-resourced, offering help with the issues that I've already mentioned, and with not only with physical help, but also mental health. Keith Brown and I visited such facilities as ministers, and Mr. Day and I visited veterans organisations in Aberdeen a long time ago now, in summer 2019. But one thing that stays with me is the necessity for peer mentoring in this field. Some veterans reject help and counselling because they believe that those mentoring them just can't understand what they have experienced. And I'm really pleased that increasingly all these charities and organisations are recognising the importance of peer mentors who, as I say, have experienced those things themselves. Presiding Officer, during COVID, charities have found it really difficult to deliver services, and I commend all those who continue to be there for those who need it. For veterans, help is there in Scotland. No one should feel it's not.
The last of the open debate contributions is from Michelle Ballantyne.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Well, many years ago, there was a saying that if the army wanted you to have a wife, they would have issued you with one. And as a young army wife, one of my first experiences was giving evidence to an inquiry on how to improve life for families and prevent soldiers from leaving the forces earlier than they might have done. Well, I'm glad to say that the last 38 odd years has seen positive change, not least because of the partnership working between the UK government, the devolved administrations, and the private, public, and third sectors. And this is a partnership that's been underpinned by a recognition that our soldiers, sailors, and airmen, and women, have a right to a family life. And they should also be able to trust that the country they served well will not forget them after their service ends. The annual report has a number of very welcome messages about the progress that is being made, and that this is despite the challenges that the COVID pandemic has thrown up. The commitment to rolling out the Scottish Veterans Care Network particularly is to be warmly welcomed. And I hope the Minister will tell us more about how the network will be promoted and how the Scottish Government will ensure that no veteran will find themselves unclear about where to go to get help, when and where they need it. Equally, ensuring that the first-class training that many service personnel receive can find equivalency in the world of work outside the forces is a really positive step forward, because there is absolutely no doubt about it. The British Armed Forces provide some of the best training anywhere in the world. Despite efforts to increase the length and stability of postings, forces life still involves moving around and coping with separation. And for children, potentially having to move schools every couple of years means the upheaval of making new friends, tackling a new curriculum if you move between education systems, and re-establishing hobbies and club memberships. Alongside this, service families are often dealing with the stress and worry of their loved one being sent to serve in an area of conflict. It is important that schools and teachers are given the skills and understanding of recognising and understanding the impact this has on children. And I'm pleased to see this recognised in the update, and the idea that school records can now be flagged so that all school, all people within the schools can recognise when that child may have a parent serving or away on active duty, I think is an excellent step forward. But equally, the partners of serving members, for the partners of serving members, building and sustaining a career can be difficult. And in the modern world, especially when a serviceman leaves the forces and you have to settle, often dual income is required. So building your career is really important. And if you want to move with your partner, you have to be ready and prepared to change jobs and find openings where you can. So I was really pleased to see that the General Teaching Council for Scotland is working with the Navy Families Federation to produce a joint documentation that hopefully we're going to see this month, detailing the requirements for teaching in Scotland. But I would like to ask the Minister to comment at the end as to why the government isn't challenging some of the obstacles that GTCS create for teachers registered in other nations of the UK. Surely our schools could look at those individuals who are registered elsewhere and decide if they want to employment, so that the requirement, for example, for an English registered teacher to have to register again with the GTCS strikes me as both bureaucratic and unnecessary, and prevents schools in areas like Moray being able to benefit from the armed forces community quickly and efficiently where there are teacher shortages. I am also concerned that if the pilot currently being run in colleges extends GTCS registration requirement to college tutors as is proposed, then this will place further unnecessary barriers to those in the armed forces families who wish to teach when posted to Scotland. But I am going to finish on a positive, and I do want to join some of the comments that have been made today in echoing congratulations to the Minister Graham Day, because he has had an extremely non-partisan, committed approach to our armed forces and veterans. And I think we should all ensure that we follow in his example as time goes on. Thank you.
Well, our extra time has largely been used up, so we move on to the closing speeches in 5 minutes, please, to Jackie Bailey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I thank the Scottish Veterans Commissioner for all his work, and the Minister too. Perhaps a career-ending moment to be praised by Mike Rumbles, Michelle Ballantyne, and now even by me, for goodness sake. Presiding Officer, I very much welcome this debate and support many of the points made in both the Scottish Government's motion and, of course, the Labour amendment. The speeches that have been made this afternoon show that there is a genuine cross-party desire to ensure that Scotland's ex-servicemen and women are supported and protected, both during this crisis and going forward. And in relation to the future of the Black Watch, first raised by my colleague Alex Rowley and then by others across the chamber, including Keith Brown, I think we speak with one voice on that issue. My constituency has a large armed forces community, made up of both veterans and current forces personnel who are serving our country at Her Majesty's Naval Base Clyde, as well as all over the UK and much further afield. Over my 21 years, if you say it quickly, it doesn't sound so bad. Over my 21 years as an MSP, I've seen firsthand the complex and unique set of needs that veterans have and the huge contribution that they can make to their communities. I welcome the decision that was finally taken earlier this year to include a question in the census, which will provide information on whether someone has served in Her Majesty's Armed Forces. Having a better understanding of the profile and needs of veterans is a key part of making sure our public services are tailored for our armed forces community. However, there are legitimate concerns from trusted organisations like Poppy Scotland in regard to the delay to the census. It is feared that that delay will not only result in Scottish returns being out of sync with other parts of the UK, but could also hinder the planning and delivery of welfare services, both in the charitable and statutory sectors, because they rely on accurate information about veterans and their families. So whilst members supported the census order, this is an issue that can only be properly addressed by working closely with the UK government to minimise the negative impact that that delay will have on our veterans and their needs. I welcome Graham Day's commitment in his motion to working continuously with the UK government and the other devolved nations. He'll know I'm a great believer in actions speaking louder than words, and we will continue to take a keen interest in that developing relationship in this area, not least in my role in the cross-party group on armed forces veterans and their families. Let me turn just now to COVID, because servicemen and servicewomen have been actively engaged in meeting the challenges of the pandemic head-on since the very beginning. The military have transported vital medical equipment and resources to and from our hospitals. They have contributed their time and energy by helping at testing centres across Scotland and indeed in my community in Dumbarton and Helensburgh. At the height of lockdown, the Royal Air Force were also assisting with airlifting critically ill COVID patients from the most remote islands to hospitals in order to ensure that they received medical attention as soon as possible. And they have our heartfelt thanks across this chamber for all that they have done to help and support our communities during these really tough times. We all know how hard this year has been for many communities across Scotland, not least for our armed forces community and all those who usually dedicate their time to supporting them. So organisations like SAFA, Poppy Scotland, Veterans Scotland and many more carry out invaluable work which supports veterans as well as acting as a voice for them. Their ability to raise vital funds will have been severely impacted by the pandemic, and the Scottish Government, I hope, will provide the support that these organisations need to survive this period. It's also important to remember that armed forces communities are made up of so much more than just the serving officers or indeed the veterans. The spouses and children of serving personnel and veterans have needs too, but they offer a huge level of skill and talent to our local areas. So I welcome the recognition for family-specific support within the UK government's strategy for our veterans, which I'm aware that the Scottish Government contributed to. I hope to see that continued support for our veterans and their families going forward. And finally, just to leave the Minister with two things to do, because I particularly want to highlight a couple of areas that I've raised with him before. The first is about additional funding for the education of armed forces children, some of whom may have additional needs. There is a need for more targeted funding from both the UK and the Scottish Government at a local level for the schools that these children are in. And secondly, and lastly, Presiding Officer, the spouses of military personnel represent a huge reservoir of talent. Can I say as gently as I can to Michelle Ballantyne, some of them might indeed be men and not just women. They could be doctors, teachers, entrepreneurs. Let's encourage them. There are organisations in Helensburgh and elsewhere that do exactly that. I would commend them to the Minister and urge him to provide them with more support. Thank you.
Call Edward Mountain, 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As an ex-serviceman, I'm really pleased to see that there continues to be almost total cross-party support to improve the support that the services are given and also to the veterans of our armed forces community. Long may it continue. I also welcome the combined approach that has been taken by the UK government and the three devolved governments to create a joint strategy for our veterans, a strategy that promises to improve support and empower our veterans' communities. Now, while the coronavirus pandemic has presented new challenges to these communities, such as the recent cancellation of the formal remembrance ceremonies last week, I'm delighted to see how the UK government has stepped in to provide more help in these troubled times During the summer, an extra £6 million worth of funding was made available to Armed Forces charities to support veterans and their families through the pandemic. We've also, as we've heard, seen the launch of HeadFit, a new online mental health service to help everyone in our defence community. This, I believe, is a really important step forward, because we all know and recognise it's not just physical wounds that need healings. Sometimes there are mental challenges that lay hidden for years and are very difficult to deal with that need to be addressed. Now, one measure that I want to mention, which I've mentioned every time since I've been in this Parliament, that will be a boost to our veterans community, is an end to the threat of the repeated historical abuse allegations. For the last 4 years, I've cited the need to stop ambulance chasing lawyers and politically motivated historic prosecutions, such as those faced by a member of my regiment, Dennis Hutchins. Too many people sit comfortably in their armchairs, deciding what they think is acceptable behaviour. Their retrospective judgments, to me, are ill-informed and unhelpful, which is why I support the Overseas Operations Bill, which is making progress through the UK Parliament. This, I believe, will offer some protection to veterans who face legal action, often decades after they have left the service. This legislation will, in my mind, right what is wrong, and I hope that all parties in this chamber will voice their support for it. Now, it's really always very difficult following Jackie Bailey in summing up, because she has done a much better job than I will do, but I will do my best. Now, let me just say at the outset, I want to also join with condemning Graham Day's future career by saying how well I think he has done. He started to get into the terminology that we hear from forces personnel, like force multiplier. He's becoming almost a soldier. And I welcome him for all that he's done. He has given a huge amount of support, and he has also stressed the importance of the Armed Forces Covenant. I'd also like to mention, Alex Reilly, I recognise, as he does, that progress is being made and the need for a veteran's mental health plan. That is so vital. And I also want to mention something that he mentioned there, and that is the importance of the families that make up our army together. It is those families, those regiments, that are so important in protecting veterans and helping veterans when they leave. And that was also taken up by Maurice Corrie, who mentioned the importance of the regimental system. And he stressed the importance of the societies and the veterans communities, especially Veterans Gateway and SAFA, two really important charities. And like Mike Rumbles, I've seen things happening, and I know he's struggled in this Parliament for a lot longer than I to get all the things he wants in, but it is really good to see that there is healthcare for veterans now coming through and is being delivered. That is good news. And I also join with Annabel Ewing, praising the veterans community for all that they do. And I also would join with her saying that it's really, really important across Scotland that we have local champions to stand up for our veterans communities. And Peter Chapman went on to mention about the Veterans Affairs Office, and I think that's really important, as are for the Unforgotten Forces. And Keith Brown, Keith Brown is an ex-veterans minister and a veteran himself, and I don't know if I can damn his career as well, but I would pay tribute to the work that he did in that role when he was there. I think we should recognise that, in the same way that he also recognised the work that Maurice Corrie had done and Graham Day was doing. I'd also just very briefly like to mention Mary Fee and the fact that she mentioned the importance of the coming home and also combat stress. And Maureen Watt, I think it made a really important and salient point, is that we all have a duty of care to our armed forces veterans. Michelle Valentine, I'm not sure that when I joined, I was ever issued with wife, but she did make the importance of the family. And I absolutely know that when I went off to do the things that I was asked to do by the armed services, it was my family that stuck by me and made things happen at home. Now, Presiding Officer, in closing, I would like to say we should never underestimate the sacrifices our armed forces make to serve and protect our country, both at home and overseas, defending our country and now helping to defend our health. We should never forget they are always prepared to give their all. And in return, it is right that they ask us to give our all for their families. And so this support, in my mind, is a small price to pay. And I can't let this pass by saying, as indeed I believe that support would be shown by this government making a commitment to work with the UK government now to ensure that our troops, where they can legally travel home for Christmas. It's the least we can do. Thank you.
Now call Graham Day. If you would take us to decision time, please, Minister, at 10 past.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A rainforest has died in the cause of my taking notes of members' contributions this afternoon. As a former convener of the Environment and Climate Change, I hope I can do justice to that sacrifice over the next 9 or so minutes. Alec Rowley asked, are we doing enough for veterans? The honest answer is no, but as he and others acknowledged, very considerable progress has been made. However, we will only continue in that vein, in a spirit of collaboration, and I commit the Scottish Government to that now and in the future. With regard to Alec Rowley's amendment, which Jackie Bailey also focused on, I'm happy also to commit the Government to continuing to work with veterans' charities to try and address the undoubted challenges that the pandemic has posed and is posing them. There is, helpfully, a realism out there in the sector that, given the wide impacts of COVID, charitable giving, in a general sense, is going to suffer. Now, the bigger charities have the option of deploying judiciously some of their reserves, and I know of instances where that's being planned for. With the smaller ones, of course, that is less of an option. Veterans Scotland, who the government funds, is there to direct and assist them. And I'll be speaking at their AGM next week when undoubtedly this topic will be covered. Building upon the Unforgotten Forces model of close collaborative working, avoiding duplication, strikes me as one way forward for the sector. And I hope I can offer Alec Rowley reassurance on the extent to which the sector and the Scottish Government is alive to the challenges current and future. I should also say, in relation to funding, the sector has been able to access mainstream charitable funds. For example, a number of veterans' charities applied to and were successful in securing support from the Scottish Resilience Fund. I don't have exact numbers, but by way of illustration, more than 60 applications were received from Legion Scotland branches and clubs. In addition to this, of course, as we've heard, the Scottish Veterans Fund is available to charities, and there is, sorry, I think, £200,000 there this year. And I should add that we held two events to provide support and guidance in completing the application form for that fund in an effort to encourage bids from new and perhaps smaller projects. So, as I say, I hope I've offered some reassurance to Alec Rowley. Maurice Corrie was commended for his work with the cross-party group by Keith Brown, and rightly so. He went on to highlight the issue about employment, and I hold to the view that central to making continuing progress in this regard is getting those employers in the private and public sector who proactively recruit from this cohort to start to evangelise on this approach, making clear the benefits that they derive from recruiting from the veteran sector. And of course, it was important that the government played its part and provided an example. Mike Rumbles was on familiar ground in referencing the issue of equity of access to services. He acknowledged the delay in the rollout of the care network had been unavoidable, and he asked for a detailed briefing for members. I'm more than happy to commit the government to do that. I think a number of MSPs, given their interest in the subject and their contributions today, would not only benefit from hearing about the work that the network is going to do, but I think they might actually contribute some thinking here in the same way that veterans and their representative organisations have already done so. Annabel Ewing, like myself, Presiding Officer, is a fan of the V1P model. But I was quite concerned to learn of her worries about housing adaptations, and I would be happy to meet with her and discuss those in due course. Indeed.
Maurice Corrie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. talking about V1P, I have a concern, and as your predecessor obviously knows, that what certainty can you give this chamber that the health boards in Scotland will incorporate and deliver Veterans First Point due to the challenges your predecessor faced in previous times?
Graham Day.
So as Maurice Corrie knows, we cannot instruct health boards to do this, but there is an incentivisation there with co-funding on the model. But I would say to him further that personally I view the future as being based upon that type of access model right across Scotland, and I think the care network can start to deliver that type of consistency in what's available regardless of where you live in the country. A number of members, Alec Rowley, Keith Brown, Annabel Ewing, raised the issue of the Black Watch, and I would associate myself with their views and concerns. I will raise this issue in discussions with Lieutenant General James Swift tomorrow. He's the Chief of the Defence Personnel, in a virtual call. It may be that the story is wrong, but if it isn't, then like Keith Brown and others, I say let's get together on a cross-party basis and say no to what is being talked of. Mary Fee noted the importance of mental health services for veterans. I agree entirely, and that's a driver for the new network. Whether it's raising better understanding of veterans' needs, giving veterans greater confidence that they will be better understood if they present to mainstream services, it's about that trust that Mary Fee talked about. And if they ask for help, they'll know that it will be there on whatever locality and available on an equitable basis across the whole of Scotland, something that Mike Grumbles has championed. Peter Chapman rightly highlighted the role of the military in responding to the challenge set by the pandemic. And it was a timely reminder, I think, for wider society and wider employment of the skills that are gained through military service, not necessarily always the obvious ones, but a lot of other skills. And I certainly know that in government, a number of departments were very impressed by what they saw in terms of what the military had to offer. I would thank Keith Brown for his kind words, and others for the same. But I have to recognise, Presiding Officer, that I stand here building on the foundations that Keith Brown established. We would not have made the progress on veterans' issues without his original endeavours, not the least of which was the establishment of the Veterans Commissioner post. Maureen Watt recognised the importance of peer mentoring. And I have to say, one of the most striking things I've seen in my travels as Veterans Minister was a mentoring service within BT, where they recruit very proactively from the sector. And they have a mentoring service to assist individuals to settle into the roles there, and it appears to work very, very well. Michelle Ballantyne, I'll pick up on the issue about the GTCS and come back to her on that. She also talked about spousal employment as an area that we need to improve upon, and I completely agree with that. I've made visits to various locations, Lookers, Faswayne, and met with wives there and heard the stories of their experiences. We can undoubtedly do better. I have to say some of the most striking interactions I've had in this role have been with wives and partners. And I think if we're honest, there is undoubtedly more that can be done. But I commend the work of companies like Barclays, who have reached out on spousal employment. And I was struck when I visited them about how just little things can make such a difference to accommodate spousal employment. And I think there's a lot we can learn there in the private and public sector. Jackie Bailey noted disappointment about the delay in the census. And I recognise that disappointment. I understand that entirely. But I hope today, from what she's heard from myself today and on other occasions, gives her some comfort that we will not allow a delay in obtaining the data that she's talking about to get in the way of improving service delivery for veterans and their families. We've heard contributions from around the chamber that have highlighted the issues that we already knew. There is a willingness to pursue those, and I look forward to doing that in the coming months. Presiding Officer, this has been a thoughtful and very constructive debate. They tend to be on this subject, and I think the Parliament is all the better for that. And in keeping with that, I commit the Scottish Government to continue to work collaboratively with our partners in the public, private and charitable sectors, and to continue to build and develop new and effective partnerships to improve our support to the veterans and armed forces community. Presiding Officer.
That concludes the debate on the Scottish Government support for the Veterans and Armed Forces community in Scotland 2020. And it's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is decision time. There are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. And the first question is that Amendment 23370.1 in the name of Alex Rowley, which seeks to amend Motion 23370 in the name of Graham Day, on Scottish Government support for the Veterans and Armed Forces community in Scotland 2020 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Oh, sorry, I didn't realise my mic was still on. The amendment is therefore agreed, according to Catherine. And the final question is that Motion 23370 in the name of Graham Day, as amended, on the Scottish Government's support for the Veterans and Armed Forces community in Scotland 2020 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. And that concludes decision time. Shortly move on to the next item of business.